Welcome to the demonstration. In this scenario, we are going to show you how we build web parts in SharePoint 2010 using Visual Studio. If you see the features wise, lot of things can be highlighted. The first and foremost thing is that web part now got a visual designer support. You design the web part automatically, a wrapper, Visual Studio itself creates it to host the designer. So what does it mean? You design become a user control. Visual Studio write the web part class that will host the user control. Previously we used to develop a user control, then we used to write a web part that hosts the user control. Now it is kind of out of the box. So the first feature is visual designer support. Second feature is Ajax support. Of course, it is built on the top of .NET 3.5 service pack 1. So everywhere you see Ajax implementation. Number 3. You can build the web part that has the interconnection. You can talk to another web part, share some data. So now it is interface based communication. You have an interface implemented in one web part, interface exposed to another web part. So SharePoint will help you to establish communication between these two web parts. Fourth feature is Silverlight support. There is a web part called Silverlight web part, allows you to host your Silverlight applications to add the richness to your user interface. So how come we are getting the richness? Because it is SVG based, scalar vector graphics based, rather using raster graphics we render using scalar vector. So that's why you get that kind of richness. Another feature is inbuilt support to streaming. Suppose if you have some media files in your SharePoint site, how will I stream that into a client browser without having to download them? So we can use media web part. That is again out of the box. Next feature is charting web part. A built-in web part that helps you to design the charts. Maybe refer the data from list, external Excel file, or maybe BCS, Business Connectivity Services, display different types of charts. Well, we acquired a product called Nanda's Charting. Having this, we are providing the charting capabilities to SharePoint site also. So now my objective is to showcase some of the demonstration with regard to how we build web parts taking advantages of these features like interconnectable web parts, visual design web part, Ajax support, Silverlight, media chart. So tell me once you are feel very tired, I will stop there itself. Now don't tell me now itself. Content query web part, well, we'll discuss when it comes to the VCM. Don't worry. Yeah. I have a separate session on that content query. So let us go to 2010. We say empty SharePoint project. Create a new solution called web parts. Visual web part solution. Visual web part project. So now, there's a good thing about a solution development, especially when it comes to web parts or a particular feature. Suppose if you're not a SharePoint administrator, or you don't have a permission to deploy your solutions on the farm level. Such cases, SharePoint 2010 has provided a feature called deploying at the web application or the particular site collection level. This is called deploying in a context. That means sandbox to solution deployment. So whenever you build the solution in the Visual Studio, it gives an opportunity. Do you want to build a sandbox solution? That means you will run in a restricted environment. You are not allowed to perform accessing your system resources like a file system, a registry, networking. This is not allowed. You can do some simple activities like accessing your list, display some data. So such cases, you can always, it's always recommended to build a sandbox solution. So you don't have to acquire SharePoint server administrator permission, or you don't have to always deploy your packages into farm level. Okay, so let us validate. We are going to deploy at the site collection level. Finish. Add a new item. Visual web part, we'll give the name as CRM search web part, customer information search web part. it says validation failed. Oh, it's still doing the work. So what it has done, it has created one CS file. That CS file internally hosts our web part. That is nothing but our control, user control, which is going to be deployed in the control templates folder. This location. And there is a descriptive file also, descriptor file also being created, dot web part. So ideally speaking, you should fill all the details about your web part, title, description, any other properties, allow resizing, allow hiding. The user control, which represents your design. So let us create a web part here. I'll add update panel. Data grid view. So we'll say allow paging. Page size is 5 records at a time. Search, we are going to search the customer information. Add a new item. CRM system. Let me get the data from my database. So Server Explorer. Internet customers, open show table data. BCS. There is already one built-in web part. You don't have to do that. For example, if you have a, there is a built-in web part called business item web part, displays one item. There is a web part which will query to filter and display the results. But still, you can make use of BCS API programmatically to query and get the data to populate it.
If you want to do some manipulation,
yes, you can. Okay. So on the click of this button, we will. Add a new item, select map to folder, config, new item, configuration, web.myweb.config. This is new feature. By default, in SharePoint 2007, all your configuration required for your application go into one web.config, correct? Now SharePoint 2010 says that we will provide a feature called supplemental web configuration files. Supplemental web configuration file means during the web part development, you also specify these are all the configuration need to be provided along with my site configuration. But those won't be added directly by you to the web.config. You will provide a separate configuration file which will be deployed in the config folder of your SharePoint system. Now we already see a lot of web config dot star.xml. So your SharePoint server will merge all the webconfig started XML contents into the site web.config, so that your configuration kept away from your the original configuration provided by SharePoint. When I create a SharePoint site, I get some configuration. Those configuration kept away from your configuration, so that even if they try to upgrade, apply the service packs, your configuration remains separated. So take advantages of supplemental configuration. Yes. No. Web.config available in the site only, because IIS requires that. SharePoint will merge them, all the configuration, into web.config of site. Now we'll take any one of the configuration settings and try to add our connection string. C colon program files. Common files, Microsoft shared web server extensions, 14 configuration. So they're adding some path here. I would like to add configuration, config setting, connection strings. Add app settings. Add path. Should start from the app settings here. Add ID equal to some GUID to be generated. Specify the path also. Path configuration / connection strings. So put the connection string properly. Add connection string equal to data source RAM Win7 integrated. Security equal to SSPI, initial catalog equal to install training DB, provider name, system.data.sql client, name equal to install training DB. Okay. Sorry? Great. So now let us try to get the logic done. So when I click the button, I should query and get the data. Try catch exception. I'll have the label. Your name is status. Label 1 2 dot state text equal to string dot format. Error occurred. Exception dot message. Okay. Use connection string equal to configuration manager. Install Training DB. Using context object equal to new CRM system data context connection string. Filtered customers equal to customers.where data grid view 1 dot data source equal to filtered customers grid view 1 dot auto generate columns equal to true. Okay, that's right. Web to config mywp.xml, so it automatically put the web config star.xml, so it will search everything and append it. Let's deploy. Rebuild it. Perfectly alright. Let us deploy. Oh, it's not compatible to the sandbox to solution. So I should remove the configuration. So in the next demonstration, in the farm solution, we'll deploy this. Configuration, because it has to be deployed in the site collection level. Site collection level cannot modify the web.config.
Say, for example, I have
that whether it is going to be changing the same configuration file, or I'll see that. I for time being will hard code it. Initial catalog equal to deployment type template file of file ACX is not compatible to feature in a sandbox solution. So it means that it is not even allowing to deploy any files, additional files. Which one? Yeah, supported. For example, let me create a new webpart project only. MP SharePoint project, demo webpart project. It's not a sandbox, it's a sandbox solution. Okay. I will create a normal webpart. So we'll simply say that something, it's not allowing to deploy any additional files to along with the sandbox solution. So now it is deployed.
There is no additional
file. ASX is additional file, no? Control templates have to be deployed. See, this ASX file had to be deployed in the control templates directory. So this additional file we are deploying. That's what the sandbox solution is giving an error. This very clearly it says that. See? Not compatible. The ASX not compatible with the feature because it's not able to deploy it. That's the error we got in the configuration also. Sorry? Correct. This visual WPF. This is going to be deployed in the 14 hive.
Control template.
That's what I'm saying. It's going to be deployed in the control templates.
That's why maybe it's not
available.
Yeah.
Can we change that part to point
to virtual
directory. Will you deploy the control site-specific template? We don't have any options here. Can we deploy from Visual Studio to site-specific virtual directories? I don't think so. Yeah, correct. We do that. We do that. Not Visual Studio does it. Yeah. So, no, there's a point. The error is, it's not able to deploy any additional files in the sandboxed environment, in the 14 hive.
When we create a sandbox solution itself during the creation of the project, it means like it is going to be with the limited privileges, right? So, when we're creating it, it should have been restricted.
Oh, the Visual Studio project template might not checking that. Okay, now I'll make this as a normal project, empty SharePoint, CRM search, web part solution. Form solution, validate. Now I can create additional configuration files or web parts also. Now let us add a new copy, paste it. Okay, add a new mapped folder, config, new item, XML. webconfig.mywebpart.xml. I deleted, should be there in the recycle bin. Restore. Reference to few web.dll also. System.web.dll. Data context has problem. Copy and paste the DBML file also. Right. Should be resolved. Update panel. Web.extensions. Okay. Data context, are you missing the namespace? We got the system data. Copy. Why it is not copying the whole project? Paste it. Yeah, correct. Link you. System.data or link you. Okay. Because we copied and pasted, no? That's why we have to add several references. When you create the linkUtsql, SQL, it adds many references. When you create a update panel, automatically add some references. So we are missing that. So let us deploy. Good. Now we'll see our program files, common files, Microsoft shared web server extensions, 14, config, webconfig.mywp.xml is also copied, and my SharePoint site. With connection strings, okay, let us run this program, see how it works. So let me create a new page. Let's say web part page, demo web part page created in the shared documents. Let's add the web part. Custom, our web part name is CRM search web part. Add it. Stop editing. Trader, so we should be able to find out some trader details. There. display the error at least, right? Or we don't have any records. Readers there. Reader. Sorry? Let me locate the worker processes. WPF and Windows forms and all we don't require. So I thought the same implementation I did with this. We'll deploy. There we go. So we got the records populated in AJAX mode. Okay, so one thing is pending. Why it is not able to access my configuration? It should have updated my configuration. My site configuration. Connection string should have been populated here. Coded, but the deployment should happen, right?
Okay,
in
that
okay, let me see the why it is in. This is the way we create it. You create a mapped folder, choose a configuration, ensure that you create always XML file, should be like a web config star any name star dot XML, then the tag we wish to attach, and then specify in which location you want to add. So this is the location I want to add. Is it because we don't have any connection strings not adding? I should check that.
Maybe the path is not existing. Configuration slash connection strings. We search for that in the web config, we can find it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we'll add some dummy entry here. Otherwise actions, there's also another I got a doubt. Config, open these two XML. Always actions only. Not connection string, actions. Okay, let us deploy and see. employee succeeded. Let us refresh. It should work as usual. Now let's go and have a look at the web.config of our site. It's there in the IIS sites. 533 is updated recently. No man, it's not. This is the idea what SharePoint follows. Your solution specific configurations, wherever being activated, that web.config needs to be merged with this configuration settings. That's the idea. Whenever you create a solution, some point of time, some web application, some site, you have to activate it. Correct or not? That site web.config need to be merged with this configuration settings. Yeah, any site you use will have a web.config, this configuration thing get merged. Yeah, that's the idea. I will check that why it is not doing that. What you should do. Anyway, now we got the visual web part development work. Now let me demonstrate the interconnection. How these two web parts communicate each other. Empty SharePoint project, ICWPU solution, interconnectable web part solution. So form solution. We'll create a new item, web part. We'll say provider web part. So one web part is going to act as a data provider. Another web part will act as a data consumer. I'll develop another web part, consumer web part. Now there should be a link between these two web parts, provider and consumer. When I say link, what does it mean? So interface based communication. So the web part which provides the data should implement an interface. A web part which accepts the data should accept the interface. So I'll create one interface here. Say customer service. Get customer. Public class customer ID. Okay. If you want additional information can be added, but ID is enough for this demonstration. So the provider web part will implement it. I customer service. Okay. We'll simply say that this customer object. What is customer object? So this web part introduces a few controls. Label equal to new, label ID equal to LBL customer name, text equal to customer name, controls dot add label. I'm introducing another text box equal to text box txt customer name. Control stock add text box. Then I'll introduce a button also. Button search, text equal to search, customer ID or customer name, should be name. Okay, so button dot controls dot add button, and I'll have a event also hooked. So in the eventing, I will write the logic. Customer object equal to new customer, name equal to text box 1 dot text. Okay. So the button click, I will prepare the customer object. So I have a method called get customer service. The return type is iCustomerService. Add one attribute, customer information. So how will I return the object of iCustomerService? The current class implements iCustomerService. I can simply say return this, build it. Okay. So this web part has got three controls. On the click of this, I will prepare the customer object. The customer object is going to be shared to the consumer web part whenever server side event takes place. That is the responsibility of SharePoint when we develop interconnectable web parts. So in the consumer web part,
we can use the existing web part as a consumer.
Existing.
Just we built one
visual web part.
Visual web part.
Sure.
Yeah, you can. Okay, not necessary. If you want to inherit from SharePoint web part, that's for backward compatibility purpose, we can just inherit it. If you want to make it compatible to both ASP.NET and SharePoint, you just have to inherit from web part of UI web controls web parts also. Okay, should I modify that one? Well, then I have to make that web part to change to support this interface. Okay, you want to develop two different solutions, is it? Let us add existing project. Web parts, visual web part solution, customer search web part project. Okay, so here we just want to have the consumer web part alone, not provider web part. So we'll come up with the interface DLL class library. Customer service library. So we'll move this I customer service here to customer service library. We don't want this. Build it. So we don't need the provider web part here as per the requirement. No, this customer web part is going to act as a provider. Anyways, okay, right? Because I have designed the customer web part to provide the data. Now I'll just have to tweak it to support the provision. So in the customer search web part, I should implement I customer service. I'll add reference to first DLL, customer service library. Okay, return this customer object. Customer object default of customer and we'll also have a method to return the customer interface. Public I customer service, get customer service, return this, add one attribute so that SharePoint will understand that this is a provider. Provider of customer information. Good. Right. In the now, how do we get to know about the user is clicking the button so that we will be able to prepare the customer object here? So in the control ASX, I ensure that this button is visible to me. This guy can hook. Control. Customer search. Control. CRM search. Control. CRM search. User control. Control dot. Search button. Click. OBJ sender. OBJ arguments. Or should I use the search button or when the user selecting the customer? Should be selecting the customer, we should trigger an event. So we should not expose the button as a public object. We should expose view, customer view. Okay. Control dot customer view dot. Selection selected index changed. OBJ sender, OBJ arguments. Selected customer data key equal to customer view dot selected data key. If selected customer not equal to null, selected customer ID equal to selected customer data value to string. Customer object dot ID equal to selected customer ID. So now I should say ID, this is not name, because last demonstration we were using name as a text box. Okay. Semicolon, build it. It's okay. We have to add the strong name to this library. So provider is ready. I have to work on the consumer web part. Let us work on. First, let us complete the work of linking. Void accept customer service. I customer service. Customer service. Connection consumer. I am expecting customer information. Customer object equal to default of customer object. To customer service dot get customer. Okay. So this is a simple web part. So I should have the grid view. GV results equal to default of grid view. GV results equal to new grid view. ID equal to GV results. Enable view state equal to false. GV results dot mm, source.add.gv_results. Okay, now when I select the item, I will simply say render data. If customer ID not equal to null, I need the order collection. So I'll probably randomly I'll prepare the order. Order ID, get set. Order date, get set. Order value, get set. Orders list equal to new list of order from index in enumerable dot range of 1 to 10. I need a random object so that I can generate some random order. Select new order. I'll include the customer ID also so that we will see what is the currently selected customer ID we are getting the order. Order ID equal to string.format ord00 index order date equal to now add days random object dot next of 1 to 100. Customer ID equal to customer object or customer ID. Order value equal to random object dot next of 200 or 2000. This dot gv results dot item data source equal to orders list. This dot gv results dot auto generate column equal to true. Gv results dot data point equal to F on the data binding. Okay. Render data. Okay, so this doesn't support AJAX. The other one supports AJAX. Okay. So how do we make it compatible? We'll put the user control, remove the update panel. I'll modify the web part file so that I can easily see that customer information provider web part. This web part is going to act as a customer consumer web part. So I'll say customer consumer information info consumer web part. We are ready to deploy now. Okay, so has it deployed? My customer service library also. No, it has not deployed. See, it has got a customer search web part project, ICWPU solution, but doesn't have a customer search service library. So it didn't deploy the dependency. So for time being, we'll deploy from here. Okay, let us use this. Edit page. Remove this web part. add a web part custom, so I could see two web part. Where's my customer info provider web part? It says a CRM search web part only. This is wrong. I'll redeploy, rebuild it. Deploy. Deploy succeeded. Showing the CRM search web part because of JavaScript. Okay, let us add a new web part. Here I should see my, no, it is not coming. Any specific reason? Solution. Okay. Okay, we are ready. So let us edit the page, add the web part and see if things working. No. Wait. Okay, I think it is doing the right work only. Only thing is that the name is not updated. Consumer web part. So now we can link connections, send customer information to customer info consumer web part. So stop editing. Oh, on the selection changed. Where is the selection option? Not editable, yeah. Just have to say. Generate select button true and data key also, data key names, customer ID. Okay, so let us select search here. When I select, an error occurred. Why it is so? Let us see that in the customer report in the render data. Most probably the error should be in the providing the customer data key. Yeah, so let me put a breakpoint here. Attach to process. This is ours. How do you know? Refresh. 4176. 4176. It's not at all. I added 140. Yeah. Okay. Demo web part page. Reader. This is consumer report. Okay. Right now, what do we have? Customer object is null, so we don't render anything. When I select it, press F11. Data key is 1. Is 1. Selected customer is 1. Customer object. Yeah, so this is an issue. Deploy solution. Right. So go back to site. There we go. So now it should be perfectly all right. Select customer 2, issue the customer 2 related orders. 4, see the 4 related orders. So the communication between web parts happen through interfaces. In SharePoint 2003, we had a feature called interpage communication. From one page, one web part can talk to another web part which is located in a different page. That feature is removed from 2010 onwards. So you don't see the inter-page communication between web parts anymore. Good thing about SharePoint 2010 is that it can support multi-link, that is multi-links. For example, on provider web part can get the data from another web part. The provider web part can provide the data to another web part. So many to many relationships sort of thing. Which one? The multi-links.
Because lists and all used to connect from one list to multiple lists, and then can get from
the list can provide to the other data, but list can get from another list, isn't it?
Because there are many types of interfaces at that time.
Correct.
The row provider,
I data provider, I column provider.
Yeah.
2007 also.
Yeah, 2007 also has this feature. But the thing is that it is deprecated. You're not supposed to use that anymore.
The ASP.NET interfaces they are told to use.
Correct. Right. We have few more demonstrations, but we'll see tomorrow. Okay. The Silverlight web part, media web part, chart web part. It will take hardly max 30 minutes, 35 minutes. We'll see tomorrow. So this closes our demonstration.